No, it's not the coaches. It's the administrative assistants. I'll call them.
Oh, I thought we could fuck. Our call is 3 hours.
What are you talking about?
The heart and soul of the company, Bob Hogan, who's heard him this morning, now you're hearing this afternoon, so it's a double treat. So here he is. Humility.
Thanks, guys. Y'all with us? All the way?
Yes.
Ready to go?
Yes.
Full spirit of vitality and chivalry? Okay, so this whoa, that's loud. Is that too loud? Okay. Now is it too loud?
No, that's better.
Try harder?
You're doing fine.
Oh, thanks, guys. These are the objectives of the talk. I want to define charisma, and then I want to define humility. It's always useful to define your terms. I want to suggest that charisma is related to narcissism. I think it is. I think charisma is a code word for narcissism. That's me saying that. I've never seen anybody else say that. But I think it's true, and I'm going to suggest that we already know the data are quite clear that charismatic leaders can be destructive as because of narcissism. Then I'm going to suggest that humble leaders can be effective. This is something nobody knows. And then I'm going to distinguish between emergence and effectiveness because that has to do with the whole thing. And then I'm going to suggest that charisma is to emergence as humility is to effectiveness. That is to say, charisma enables and propitiates emergence, and humility propitiates or enables effectiveness. And they're not the same, they're statistically pretty much independent. So that's what it's all about. So, charisma. Charisma actually, I had this great slide, it doesn't seem to be here. It comes from Anton Mesmer and the development of hypnosis in the 18th century in Austria, and then in people who have this animal magnetism could just compel you to do their bidding by just kind of looking at it. Mesmer thought he had it. His deal was he cured illnesses through his animal magnetism. Anyway, charisma is related to animal magnetism. It has to do with stage presence and being a forceful character, and then people just feel, they just fall in line with what you have in mind because of the sheer power of their charisma. Humility is defined as freedom from, I'm writing an essay on this. Using the essay in my head. So yeah, so humility, by the way, is advocated by or proposed or set up as a positive virtue by all the great world religions, every single one of them. And they talk about humility in exactly the same things, same terms. So humility is not about being laying down and letting dogs pee on you. Humility is about being free of pride. That's what Nietzsche said about St. Francis of Assisi. Humility is freedom from pride or arrogance, the folly or state of low self preoccupation. So people with humility are not preoccupied with themselves. They don't spend a lot of time doing tweets. So charisma and narcissism are correlated in leadership samples. That's why I aligned it, that charisma is a code word for narcissism. Charismatic narcissists, people who are both known as charismatic and can be identified through assessments as narcissistic, they won't accept responsibility for failure. I met a home builder when I first moved to Tulsa, who was like, told me he was $20 million in debt. His last name was Never Fail. They won't accept responsibility for failure. They take more credit for success. If it goes well, it was me. If it goes badly, it was you. They won't listen to feedback. They can't learn from experience. They won't listen to feedback. Because they won't listen to feedback, they can't learn from experience. They feel entitled to leadership positions. That's my job. I mean, that belonged to that. All I was destined for this. And they ruin companies. And the data are really clear on this. And so it's slick research. You take the annual report, and you see whose picture is featured in it. And if it's just the CEO, that's a one. And if it's CEO plus folks, that's a zero. And then you look at the annual report itself and see how many times the word I is used. And each time the word I is used, you get a score. So you can assign companies and CEOs a score for narcissism based on whose picture is there and how. And the data, and then using that as a measure of narcissism, you can compare that to company performance. And the answer is narcissistic CEOs ruin companies. So they ruin companies, the CEOs. But they, you know, they make a lot of noise as they go down in the flames. I'm not a businessman, and I don't know a whole lot about business history, but certainly after World War II, typical CEO's salary was about three times that of everybody else. They were regarded essentially as caretakers, you know, guys who would do the bidding of the board, but it was not regarded as a high power position. But in the 1970s, T. Boone Pickens and a guy Carl Icahn, activist investors concluded that they ought to get more for their money, that they needed more, and that the way they get more for the money is with better, higher performing CEOs. There was a guy named Jensen at Harvard invented the word agency there. He invented the idea that CEO pay should be tied to the performance of the stock, and that's where the stock options, the whole business about stock. That's just been here since the mid-1970s. And it came from activist investors wanting to get more money out of their stock, and then this idea of paying CEOs for performance. Okay, so companies then begin hiring CEOs based on their apparent potential to deliver higher value, right? Well, guess what kind of person will guarantee better financial results in a job interview? I can make America great again, right? I can get this company moving again. That's how they talk. That is how they talk. I mean, that could be an item from a narcissism scale. It's all about me. So companies began to hire CEOs who they thought would deliver better results. Guess who always guarantees better results? Guess who always wins the job interview then? And so organizations think they need charismatic leadership, but what they actually get is, they get charisma, but they also get narcissism. You all following the argument?
Sure.
And where all this came from? There's a definite historical. Let's see what it says. Terry, you get it?
I got it.
Yeah. Terry and his friends are going to take over South Carolina. The plot's underway. That's what Nikki Haley's all about. Nikki Haley's in constant communication with Terry. He's writing her speeches these days. So this is something I stole from Scott Gregory. I steal all my best stuff from Scott Gregory. This is Charisma Invades the Culture of Business. There's a website called IndeedWhat.com. It lists 224,526 jobs that require charisma as an essential part of, you know, the capability that enables performance. You got that? And Indeed lists 3,342 jobs that require humility. See if you can guess which attribute our culture most favors. Demands, requires. It's just part of the culture. It's part of the water we drink. Okay. So, charisma has consequences, he says. Both of these guys rose to the tops of their country's political hierarchies based on charisma. Yes, they did. Both were self-serving narcissists, both enjoyed limited, but really, they have real supporters. The people who support them are serious about supporting them. And they both had mixed legacies, some wins, some losses, some wins, some losses. We'll see about the second guy that we know all about, the first guy, who had some wins and a lot of losses. Okay, humility has its consequences too. When I was a midshipman, my freshman naval science class, we had to read, had a course on the history of naval warfare, and that's where I learned about Nelson, Admiral Lord Hyde. And go to Wikipedia and look up the Nelson touch. And reading that as a freshman naval science, I said, wow, that sounds like I have. His troops loved him. His subordinates were crazy about it. I mean, just they idolized him. He spent all his time out at sea doing the job. He spent no time back at Whitehall doing politics. He saved England from the French Navy. He saved England, changed the course of history. But meanwhile, the politicians back in Whitehall were killing him. It was just terrible. But he was and this guy, I mean, they hated him in Washington. They hated him in Washington. Neither one of these guys ever lost a fight. Ever. This one, I just love this. I mean, his reputation. The last 2 years of the war, he led, both of these guys led from the front. The French killed him because he wouldn't get out of the way. He was always just out of the range of the Confederate rifles, about 200 yards out. And the last 2 years of the war, when the Confederate soldiers saw Grant ride by, they started cheering. The Confederates started cheering. How's that? They didn't cheer for their own guy. So, two guys, top of the hierarchy, based on their performance, not on their charisma. And they had trouble getting there because they were just doing their jobs. They weren't out there, having drinks with the president. Both were dedicated to serving their country as opposed to advancing their own careers. Both were tremendously admired by their subordinates. And they're two of the greatest leaders in history. So here we go with narcissism in business. I had some footnotes in the show. So the first guy, that's Neutron Jack. They said Neutron Jack, they said where he stepped, grass never grew again. I live on Amelia Island in Florida, and there's a Liz Carlton there, and a few years ago he showed up, I recognized him, and I was walking my dog, and here he comes down the path where I walk my dog. This guy's crazy. Anyway, his degree is in chemical engineering, which means he's quite smart. And he did great things with GE stock by leveraging GE Financial. He didn't do a damn thing for the core business. Poor old Imhoff had to take over and then unwind the GE Financial. This is it. All of management is about self-confidence, he said. That means high on adjustment. It means nothing to prove. All management is about self-confidence. This guy, this is Darwin Smith. He was the CEO of Kimberly-Clark. He was a lawyer. He was just working there. And they needed a CEO, and he seemed to be doing a good job, so they put him in charge. And this line from him, I never stopped trying to be qualified for my job. That's somebody who has something to prove. That's called low adjustment on the HPI. I got something to prove. That's what low adjustment is. I got something to prove. I don't have the numbers in front of me now. I can't remember. But while he was CEO of Kimberly-Clark, they outperformed all but two or three stocks. I mean, he was one of the absolutely best performing companies in the stock exchange for 15 years when he stepped down and called. Anyway, I never stopped trying to be a real winner, just a self-promoting turkey whose mess people are still trying to clean up. Y'all get the point? This is one, okay, yeah, so. So who are the high-profile people in an organization? Well, everyone knows who they are, right? And the high-profile guys are the ones who show up at all meetings. What's the relationship? So you can right away, you can go into any organization and say, who are your high-profile people? And everybody knows who they are because they're always there. But what's the relationship between being high-profile and being an effective leader? No one asks that question today. Well, isn't that the question? So this brings up the distinction between emergence and effectiveness, which I think is absolutely fundamental if you want to understand high-potential identification. You have to understand the distinction between emergence and effectiveness. This brings up Luthen's book, which we own. Hogan, we own the book. We're bringing out a new an edition of it that can actually be read. Hogan was a technical reporter, which is impossible to read. And so this is absolutely essential. This is one of the most important pieces of leadership. One of the most important empirical pieces of leadership research ever. 357 managers from from a variety of organizations, and he studied them for 4 years, and he had a massive amount of data. They followed him around and recorded what they were doing on a daily basis. They had questionnaires, they had interviews, they had assessment center data, they had all tons of data on every one of these guys. And then, well, there it is, yeah. And then at the end, after 4 years, they got performance data. So you got all this predictor data, interviews, observations, subordinate ratings, superior rating, blah, blah, blah. And then you get performance data at the end. And what he found was two groups of high performers. The first group was defined by, composed of, characterized by people who advanced rapidly, who moved up quickly, who got rapid pay raises and rapid promotions. They were the high, the way they went up to the top. And then the second group were people whose teams were performing well. Now the definition of leadership says moi, is the ability to build and maintain a high-performing team. Definition of leadership is not about getting chosen, being the chosen one. It's about getting your team, your organization, your unit responsible, getting it to perform at a high level. So two groups, one group that is recognized as high performance, high potential, and the second group whose units were actually performing very well. There's a correlation of about 0.3 between members, so it's about a 10% overlap between the two groups. So there were some people who were both high and high. Those who advanced rapidly, I call those high emergers, those who advanced rapidly spent all of their time networking, on the phone, talking to folks, getting on television, you know. So all the time networking. The people whose teams performed well spent all of their time working with their team. These guys spent no time with the team, they spent time on the phone. These guys spent all their time with the team and spent no time on the phone. You all see? And they're basically not the same groups. So what do you want? Who do you want running your company? So this is also really important work that I think most people don't understand. He himself didn't understand, I think, what he had done. He was kind of a structural sociologist. He wanted to study organizational effectiveness, which is almost no one studies organizational effectiveness. But he was looking for the keys to organizational effectiveness as factors in the, you know, in the democracy, in the tax laws, legal structures, economic changes, blah, blah, blah. So, and you all know the story. Fortune 1000 companies found 11 companies that had 15 years of mediocre performance, and then real mediocre, and then 15 years of performance, sustained performance, significantly better than their industry sector. And then he said he was looking for structural things, the way the organization was set up, their bylaws, their owner's manuals, and shareholders agreements, or something. And what he concluded, he said he was really didn't believe it at first, was it was the CEOs that were driving the performance. It was just them, and then he said they were all the same. He said it was like what's his name from Kimberly Clark. He said you go in the room, you couldn't tell who the CEO was because they were just understated, calm, relaxed, not self-promoting. They were just there doing their jobs, and so he said they were really humble, but he said they were also phenomenally competitive. They were really, really tough. But you know, if you're really tough, you don't have to be telling people you're tough. You just go ahead and be tough, right? Be the people. He doesn't say this, but when I read that the first time, I said, say goodbye to the myth of charismatic leadership. None of these guys were charismatic. None of these guys were narcissists. They were all humble and fierce. Just like Nelson and Graham. Are you all with me?
Yes.
And this is really important stuff. I mean, we spend all our time, the first thing that we did as an organization was try to highlight the fact that most of these guys aren't any good. The companies routinely put the wrong people in charge. Countries routinely put the wrong people in charge. So there's a whole long line of years of stuff on what the characteristics and bad ones. But we also know something about the good ones. It's just not what anybody wants to hear. Which is a whole loose for us. I just tell folks stuff they don't want to hear. So this is a really interesting study that was just published last year by the business school at MIT. MIT is an engineering school, and it's real good. And this is a great study. MIT graduates, as a collective group, have started 30,200 businesses. And that's what they do. They leave MIT and they start a business. And those businesses collectively have 4.6 million employees and $1.9 trillion in annual revenues. That's the MIT group. Okay, the annual revenues of these companies started by MIT grads, but fall behind Russia, but ahead of India. I'm thinking like that. And they have a shared model, pattern, stereotype, program of leadership. They have a shared, it's being problem-focused, you know, it's not about me, it's let's solve the problem. Technically competent, as in you need to know what you're talking about if you want to be in charge. Open-minded, that is, you know, what else do you got to tell me, what's news, what's going on out there. Data-driven decisions, for God's sake. Apolitical, just, you know, what's the right answer, how do we make this work better, collaborative, and avoid the trappings of leadership. They're humble, you know, small offices, sitting out among the troops. It's nothing about them, it's all about the company and all about solving problems and getting better. That's their model of leadership. And well-known, the equipment's attacking me again. This guy, Mark Ioni, was amazing. He's an amazing guy. He fixed Fiat. Fiat was going down. And then he comes to Chrysler and he fixes Chrysler. He fixed it. And then he was going to fix General Motors, but they wouldn't let him. This guy, Herbert Jolly, he's been this, Best Buy was gone. They were going down. They were going broke. He came on board as CEO 18 months ago. There they go. This dude, Alan Mulally, Ford was broke. Ford was going in. They were in the tank. They brought him on board. Boom. And when he retired, they've been going down ever since. And then also here, this guy, Larry Culp, who just took over as CEO of GE, like last week. He fits exactly this profile. Watch, I promise you, he'll fix GE. So these guys all fit the same pattern that I'm talking about, which is what I would call humble leadership. Not servant leadership, humble leadership. Okay, so what do you get out of these guys? You get quiet self-confidence. They don't have to tell you their self-confidence. They assume you can figure it out, that they know what they're talking about. They're really ambitious and really competitive, but you know they're not in your face about it. They're just going to beat you anyway. They're driven to improve performance because they think they have something to prove. We can't, it's the whole thing with Kaizen. My favorite organization is Toyota. It's dedication to Kaizen, the constant improvement. We can get better. As opposed to, I don't have anything to prove, I'm really good. You know, complacency is the opposite of and then real confidence in their chosen discipline. They know what they're talking about. And this guy, Culp. I mean, he's appointed CEO of GE, and the next day he's on a plane to go visit a factory to see what's going on at the level of the shop floor. That's how you got to do it. You got to know. You got to understand the business. Okay. So, how do you define charisma? Well, we folks in this room can define charisma quite easily. It's these four scales: bold, mischievous, colorful, and imaginative. That we call that the charisma cluster. High scores in that cluster people with high scores in that cluster are described as charismatic. So that's the charisma culture. I mean, that's what, okay, you're with them. This is just mathematically statistically how you define charisma. Okay, so with bold, you get socially poised, arrogant, entitled. That's what bold is about, and that would be Donald Trump. With mischievous, you get charming, manipulative, seductive, and impulsive, and that would be Jeffrey Skilling. Of Enron fame, who I think is still in prison, because they really do that thing. He's still in prison, isn't he? He's planning his next career. But colorful, you know, smart, interesting. So, I mean, these guys, they really are poised, and these guys really are charming, and these guys are really interesting. When they come in the room, they light up the room. They also take all the oxygen out. That would be Bill Clinton. And then imaginative, you know, creative, impractical, eccentric, you know, full of ideas. That's Elon Musk. And I think all those guys failed. Well, one of them's in prison. I don't know how long Elon Musk is going to be able to stick at it for years. Okay, so here's a study published by our friend Ralph Kaiser in JBSB this year. Here are scores on the charisma cluster. Okay, normalized scores are up from 0 to 100. And then this line is self-ratings for effectiveness. So the higher you score on the charisma cluster, the more likely you are to rate yourself as highly effective, right? You all understand that?
Yes.
Higher you score on charisma, the more you're going to tell other people how good you are. The more you're going to tell them you can bring the financial results that they need, right? And these are staff ratings for effectiveness. And what you get is, in that range there, the staff does in fact see them as effective or passed sort of point their effectiveness. Isn't that, isn't that great? So it's a curvilinear thing. You got to have some juice to make things happen, but past a certain point, people think you're just a blowhard, or a chimney suit, or a dean at a major university. Okay, are you all with me? I mean, you all see the point of this, right?
Yes.
Actually, we have a dean from a major university in our room, and that comment was aimed at him, but he's not a blowhard, he's a good guy. Okay, so this is what they look like behaviorally. These are descriptors of people with high scores on humility. They acknowledge their mistakes and limitations. They say, that was a mistake. I shouldn't have done that. Just like George Bush after he invaded Iraq, right? I mean, the bad ones double down. They say, that was not a mistake. Watch. So they acknowledge their mistakes and limitations. That's how you learn. They spotlight up. They recognize other people's contributions. They listen to and learn from other people because they know they got something to learn. They make fun of themselves. That, you see that all the time. They actually make fun of themselves. Do you think Donald Trump is capable of making fun of himself? Do you think Bill Clinton is capable of making fun of himself? I mean, they're really thin-skinned. They don't feel entitled. They think they have to earn their status, their privilege, or earn their spurs every day. And they have egalitarian values. So they say, if you can do the job, you're good. If you can't, then we need somebody else. So those are behavioral descriptors this is what they do. They focus on the team performance, not on their own careers. It goes back to the Lutheran study. They focus on the team. They try to make the team work better. They channel their ambition is for the organization to succeed, not that, if the organization does well, so will you. But if it's all about you, then who knows about the organization? They foster a culture of development because they ask the people, it's learning, let's get better, it's Kaizen, go forward and forward. And they build a culture of openness, trust, and recognition because everybody gets to talk to everybody and everybody gets to participate. So we've developed a measure of humility. We're not quite sure what we're going to do with it. I think it might become part of the revised HPI because I think humility is such a powerful concept. And you can recognize it in other people. It's an easy thing to pick up from observer script. You can tell who's arrogant, you can tell who's not. But anyway, so we got this great scale, really good psychometrics. It predicts job performance, nice correlations across the board of job performance, predicts ratings for organizational citizenship, so high scores and humility, you've seen as a good organizational citizen. It negatively predicts, so if you have high scores, you don't engage. If you have high scores and humility, you don't engage in counterproductive work behaviors. Effect, the well-being of the staff likes working for them, job satisfaction of the staff, engagement of the staff. But this is, and so this is all engagement. So higher the scores, the manager score on humility, the more engagement you get the staff. What are we talking about? That's the whole ballgame, that's the gold standard. This is from a study, a recent study by a Chinese lady named Amy Wu. And so scores for humility predict. What this means is that there's not as much of a range of scale of salary at the top. They're paid on a more even-handed basis. If the CEO is humble, then the pay structure is more evenly distributed. The top management team works better together in higher team integration. This means everybody gets to contribute to this. That's a bad word. That's their terminology. It's not mine. Well, she doesn't speak English. Will be a second. I'm sure she speaks English better than I speak Mandarin. That is, everybody gets to participate, and you change the strategy when the data suggests you're going the wrong way, right? And then finally, you get better company performance. So, first study I know of, published 2015, humility in CEOs drives overall team performance. Back in the day, we were essentially an engineering organization. We were very data-driven when we were at our best, and so it's all about the data. So here for the coaches in the room is how you develop it. This is what you do. This is what you say to them. This is what you say to the arrogant shit who's sitting across from you. Make a point of recognizing other people's achievements, not your own, not as opposed to requiring them to recognize yours. Actively work to understand your own limitations. What are you good at and what you're not good at? Because you're not good at everything. People know when you screwed up. be willing to admit your mistakes. It's not a sign of weakness to say that I was wrong. I think it's a sign of courage. And I think it makes people respect you. You say, oh, that was a mistake, as opposed to lying or trying to cover it up. Ask for and listen to feedback. Understand that, you know, other people may know things that you don't know. This is a theme that just comes up over and over again. Understanding that you've got subordinates who know more about this than you do, so listen to them. It's respecting the talent that you've got working for you, as opposed to trying to tell everybody what, how to do things. Work to gain their respect. Don't assume that they owe it to you. It's because you showed up. And pay attention to your own self-promoting behaviors. And try to get them under control. Go on with that, right? Anyway, so this is what you do if you're really coach once. Easy as that, right? You can double your rates. So final thoughts. Charismatic leaders tend to focus on themselves. Humble leaders focus on the team and the organization. This is Drucker's mirror and window analogy. He says, if it goes wrong, look in the mirror. If it goes well, look out the window at those other folks. I love that. I really do. Drucker was really quite smart and intuitive about this thing. So if it goes well, you take the blame. If it goes badly, you take the blame. If it goes well, share the credit. Charisma. Understand that charisma does destroy engagement. It does, because it goes with narcissism. Humility creates engagement. What do you want? You want engagement or you want? And organizations that value charisma then often overlook their most effective leaders, which is to say that the next generation of leaders may be hiding, probably is hiding in plain sight, because they're not tooting their own horn. I mean, they just, you know, Grant had to wait to be discovered. Nelson had to wait to be discovered. So then, this next slide comes from the movie Dirty Harry. I hope this is going to work. He's been, the whole movie, this is the very end of the movie, he's been being bullied by this narcissistic officer above him. And at the end of the movie, there's a car that's got the evidence in it, and it's got something else. And the guy, he gets in the car, and he's going to drive off and take credit for the whole show. And this is Dirty Harry watching him go. Mike, do you think all I have to do is click on it?
Yeah, that's all.
Just hit the
forward button. Just like
the forward button?
Advance one slide.
Okay. The guy was just a jerk. And he could have told him, you know? I love that. That's it. Man's got to know his limitations. Do you want to do a Q&A? Yeah. Il y a des questions? Is he having a private study? Yes, Jack.
So in the Lucid study, you talked about how most of it was very little overlap between the managers who were emergent
10%.
And the managers who were effective. So what about that 10%? I mean, not to put you on the spot, but have you ever thought of like an example of someone who was both really, really charismatic, but also humble and approachable and capable of both inspiring and being noticed, but also, you know, being effective?
Yeah, maybe Lincoln. Yeah, maybe Washington. Washington was really, really good. Neither of them seemed to be there, but they were both really good. I mean, people said when Washington walked into the room, what's that line about Marco Rubio? When Marco Rubio walks into the room, young women faint, old women cry, and toilets flush themselves. I think that was when they said when Washington walked into the room, the women just started sobbing. And he was a real stud. Yeah. So yeah, I think there's some, but you know, they're not so many.
Right. Less than self.
Yes.
As a practical matter, when you're coaching someone, particularly early in their career, I mean, I guess what we're saying is, if you're going to be a humble leader, you may produce better results, but it may limit your career in some ways.
Exactly, and that's what I meant about the best leaders are probably hiding in plain sight.
I, what I was thinking about when you were talking before is Deborah Tannen's work about gender differences, and that women as a group very often tend to be more humble and flatter their team and give them recognition. And it may hold them back.
Yeah, it may also hold the curse back. Yeah, no, this is the bad news that organizations don't want to hear, that they're identifying the wrong people as their leaders. That's what we do, though, is tell people what they don't hear. If you have.
Yeah, I have a question. I just haven't answered it when I looked back at what you were saying. But do you have some concept in terms of the inverse relationship between being charismatic as versus having humility? So I understand there's a self-promoting piece of it that makes somebody charismatic, but can somebody have charisma and also be humble?
Yeah, that was Jackie's question. That was Lincoln, and that was it, Washington. I think, yeah, absolutely. But it's only going to be 10%. It's going to be a rare bird, but when you find them, they'll be really, really good. It'll be pink haired men. They're really good. Yes, sir.
Yeah, if you want to do more, if you haven't read the degree, he was a whole chapter to this level about leadership, and I find that a nice document to leave with some of these executives. And where are you? Not even executives, right? Future leaders as well. But he does a nice job in that whole chapter about level 5 leaders and Darwin Smith and other examples.
Yeah.
So it's a nice tool to use.
Yeah. Yes.
So there's a good reason you differentiate emergence to effectiveness.
Yes.
Much of what you were commenting on in humility, at least for me, seems to be very similar to what you have defined in effectiveness.
Yes, exactly.
So still, what's the difference? Or is there a difference?
No, I mean, I think the humble, if they're humble and they don't have any confidence, they're just weak. But that's the really good ones. They do all those things. They listen to their subordinates, they delegate appropriately. They're constantly learning, they understand that they can make mistakes, change course, blah, blah, blah.
So we already have...
And narcissism works against all of that. I'm sorry.
So we already have a report in which we can assess humility, which is the hypo report.
Yeah, it's sort of there. It's in that last segment called coaching. Yeah, we're going to change that out, though. Well, we're refining that. That was the impetus for this work. Yeah, you're absolutely right. Good.
German attention to detail.
Yeah, very clever. You guys know that BMW makes 1/4 of all its revenues from currency trading? Is that smart or what? That's brilliant.
That's cool.
Yeah, anyway. I don't know what that was. I admire German business.